I'm sure you, like everybody, woke up to the news that the jobs numbers were pretty incredible again this morning. Wall Street's been pricing in a cut sometime this year. Do you think that, from your perspective as how the Fed would look at it, it takes that off the table?
So it's not obvious. I can't quite tell what is the policy stance of the Federal Reserve. There's been a change in their narrative over the course of the last 4 or 5 months. So I think it's hard for markets to distill exactly the direction they're going. For the Fed, there's a little bit of risk of oversteering. Respond positively to one bit of data, respond negatively to the rest. Better for the central bank just to see how the economy plays out. Let markets come to its own independent decisions instead of trying to influence it.
Well, there's been a question about whether they should respond to the fact that inflation is moving a little bit lower and they just can't hit the 2% target. Do you think they're fine just sitting there?
So I remember this debate back from a decade ago when we were trying to figure out what price stability means. Chairman Bernanke and my colleagues established 2.0% as the inflation target. I remember being skeptical then, I'm skeptical now. The real question for central banks should be, are we in a period of price stability? I think we've been in a period of price stability for about 8 or 9 years. Alan Greenspan used to call this broadly a comfort zone on inflation. I think they're in the comfort zone. We don't measure inflation that well, to be so precise. So I hesitate to have our successors at the Fed try to fine-tune their analysis a couple of digits to the right of the decimal point.
There have been criticism on Wall Street of the Fed lately for its communications abilities, as you're mentioning, and also for the way some of the structures of policy operation were set up following the crisis, from interest on excess reserves to the balance sheet. When you look back now, would you have done things differently?
Sure, there are a lot of things I think we would have done differently in the crisis, but I think what we would have never anticipated in 2008 and 2009, even 2010, is that 10 years later, a decade after, there'd still be emergency policies being put into place. We wouldn't have expected that. And so broadly, the real question for the Fed is, are they trying to go back to a prior period of monetary policy, or are they where they want to be? So much about the conduct of policy today would have surprised us a decade ago.
Well, do you think that the execution now demands a change in part of what the whole conference is about here, demands a change in the way the Fed does business?
So I do. You've heard me say for years, I'm a reformer at this. I think there's a lot the Fed can do to fundamentally change how it approaches its job, how it communicates to markets. You know, at core, monetary policy is important, not for the decisions it makes, but for the reasons it gives, for the explanations, for the framework. And the framework to me looks like it's lurching a bit from one side to another. So because the Fed has been on the front pages now for a decade, long after the financial crisis, we shouldn't be surprised that politicians on all sides look to attack their independence, and that's what I'll talk about later today.
Do you think that the president is justified in doing that? The White House would tell you he's just offering an opinion. Critics say he's putting undue political pressure on the central bank.
So the Fed needs to ensure that it is vigilant about its independence. Chairman Powell and his colleagues need to protect their independence. People on the outside can offer all their opinions, but the Fed's independence is only breached if the Fed lets it. If the Fed calls it the way it sees it, if it is very forward-looking with policy, if it's very clear, it's really up to them to defend their independence. But I would say again, if you're on the front pages for a very long time, it is a tempting target for politicians on all sides to try to use the Fed's printing press to wander into fiscal policy, to wander into regulatory policy. And that's a big question for reform that we're going to take up today.
Well, you work in the markets now. You were on the Fed. Do you think policy is set right for the markets? Was the December move maybe a mistake, as the president would suggest?
So I don't really understand where policy is set. And again, if the important decisions that are made isn't what's policy today, what's the rationale? What's the compelling evidence the Fed's giving? Then markets can be forward learning. Businesses and households can react. But that communications message looks to me to be something I don't fully understand. So I don't really know what the current policy stance is.
Well, are we too tight? Are you seeing the economy or the markets hurt by where the Fed is, by the 2.25% to 2.5% range?
So broadly speaking, if one were to step back and look at it as objectively as you can, the monetary policy looks about as loose as it's been over the period of the last decade. And that's happening at a time that the economy appears to be in quite good shape.
The Fed is down two people right now, and there were a couple of people who we thought would be nominated who have withdrawn. Could you give us any thoughts on who you would like to see or what kind of person you would like to see appointed as a member in good standing of the conservative wing of the Republican Party? Your views should, in theory, be aligned.
Well, there's certainly a lot of staffers at the Federal Reserve who are expert, who are probably thrilled that they don't have to feed information to and respond to the questions of two new members. So everyone's probably not disappointed to have a five-member board. Listen, my judgment is what the Fed needs to do inside the Fed family is have a robust discussion about the precision in their targets, what their objective functions are, what the real risks are in financial stability, what are the supply side changes in the economy we're seeing. So some fresh thinking, I think, would be useful. You know, when Chairman Bernanke put together his team, obviously with candidates sent over, nominees sent over by the president, he didn't want a bunch of yes men. He wanted a bunch of people that had a diversity of views, diversity of backgrounds, so we'd have good, hard family fights. And each person would come to the table with different expertise in academia, in markets, in the real world. And it strikes me that's the right kind of diversity for the Fed to have. And hopefully both the chairman of the Fed and the president will find people that can bring that fresh thinking.
Well, there's been a question about whether or not the president would like to retain the current chairman. Do you think Jay Powell's doing a good job?
Jay has my full support. Jay's going to serve out his term. Everything else is just, I'd say, speculation on social media. Jay needs to be successful. We as Americans need him to be successful. He has, I think, a very tough job. I think he inherited a central bank with large ambitions, and I think he inherited a central bank with fewer good choices than his predecessors have had, certainly since the crisis. So, you know, I'm not going to be the one to criticize Jay's work because, again, I think he's got a tough job to do.
Would you ever be interested in going back to the Fed?
So Jay's going to serve out this full term. I think he's going to do a great job. We need him to. And, you know, what happens in the decade in front, I have no idea. I stuck my neck out this last time around. It ended up surviving it. And, you know, being here at Stanford with you is not a terrible backstop.
And no interest in being a governor again.
No, that one I did. That one I'm certainly not signing back up for.